Hello, everyone. My name is Eyal Ofek. I'm a principal researcher at the Microsoft Research Lab in Redmond in a group called EPIC, which is Extended Perception, Interaction, and Cognition. And my interest in research is around virtual reality, augmented reality, and as a result, in rendering haptics, the touch sensing, for those experiences. Researchers, engineers, scientists, and designers has many years interest in haptics. Among them is my colleague, Mike Sinclair, who has an immense amount of experience in the area.
Hi, everyone. My name is Mike Sinclair. I'm a principal researcher in the EPIC lab of Microsoft Research located in Redmond, Washington. Ours lab specifically looks at HCI, human-computer interface. How do we more naturally communicate with computers?
When we came out to think about haptics, our focus was on handheld devices, which are at the time were rather rare in the haptics research, and there's a reason for that. A handheld device is rather small, cannot be very heavy, it doesn't have a lot of mechanics in it, and one major difficulty is that it is handheld. So whenever it, for example, hit a virtual wall, there's nothing that will stop the hand from going through that wall. So how can we represent such objects for virtual reality? So what we brought here are several of our prototypes that shows the thought that is streaming from one prototype to another. The first one here is called NormalTouch. I can put one finger on a moving platform, and that represents one point of a virtual surface that I should touch. Now, suppose I touch an object and I want to move my hands further into the object. What the device does is that as I put my hand forward, that disc is pushing my finger backward, so I feel as if that touch point is fixed in space. Now, this has a limited range, so beyond that range, what happens is that my hand continue moving into the object, but visually, in virtual reality, I see my virtual hand stay on the object surface. And at one point, when it's too far, obviously the illusion will break. This showed quite nicely how people could feel and manipulate virtual objects. However, it's very limited in its utility. So our next thinking was that if there's gonna be a haptic controller that consumers will buy, it should be able the user to do a lot of things. And here came another prototype called the Claw.
And it consists also of a handheld controller. In this case, it's got a wire back to the computer. Normally, if it's ever reached product stage, it would be all battery operated. And you can probably see that I'm moving it. And I don't know if you can hear, but there's a little motor that is opening and closing on my finger. And on command, if it knows where my finger is, where my hand is with respect to the object I'm about to squeeze, am I picking up a grape or a marble, then as I close my finger in on my thumb, it knows when to stop that. Let's see, I'm picking up a marble and stop it abruptly. Oh, it's a hard object. Now if I'm picking up a grape, it knows when to feedback with a little bit of force and a little bit of compliance or sponginess. Oh, it's something out there that's small and round, but it gives a little bit. And if I squeeze hard enough, the system again knows it's a grape and it says, he squeezed way too hard and now we will burst the grape. And the appropriate visuals will show, and all of a sudden my index finger will come into my thumb, indicating from a force point of view, I have squished the grape.
This device was very successful and generates very nice illusion and also enables people to do different tasks in virtual reality. However, like many haptic prototypes, this is also a lab prototype that has a problem to find itself into a consumer product. two major problems, not all of them. One is the price of putting a strong motor that could be strong enough to overcome the power of human scale forces. And the second is reliability. When you have an object where you can put on the floor and stand on the hand and just burn this expensive motor, it's not something that you can put into a product. So thinking of this usability, but the problem that it shows, we went out to another prototype. This one is called the CapstanCrunch. Visually, it's very similar to the claw. I could move my index finger and my thumb to grab things. I could feel resistance as if I pick up a virtual apple, not to close my fingers. But the magic here is that we're not using a big motor. Instead, we're using a brake called the capstan here, which if it's powered by a really, really small motor that hides inside the device. And this motor is pulling a string here, and a very small power pulling the string doesn't enable me to close my hands. So this device is similar in functionality, but will be cheaper, more robust, and more energy efficient, which is important for a handheld device, much closer to the vision of having that as a consumer product.
And then next in the evolution of our haptic device is what we call TORC. And the strange thing about TORC is you'll notice there are no apparently moving parts that are brought to the outside that would move my finger. And so we play on what we can make the user think they're feeling, and what they see in their head-mounted display overrides that, and as I squeeze my finger against this plate and these plates, as I squeeze, nothing moves here other than I'm applying more force, but in the head-mounted display, I see my actual fingers move. And this is enough to fool most people to think they're squeezing something. And as an output, there are these programmable wideband buzzers that I described before, that as I squeeze, it's not a single frequency buzzing, but kind of a noisy, granular buzzing. It gives me the feeling that I'm actually squeezing something. And one other difference in this device, opposed to whatever else the other parts that we showed you, is that it has this pad on this side. And this pad is really a trackpad, like you use when your finger scrubbing a little pad on either your phone or your notebook computer, only this keeps track of where my thumb tip is, or my thumb. And it knows that my fingers are in the little detents on the other side, and it knows now that I'm doing the following manipulation. And what I'll feel is one thing, and what I see in my virtual space might be a pencil. And you know how you can manipulate a pencil even with your eyes closed. You know how to manipulate a pencil or a key or other object and do some pretty fine manipulations that you couldn't do with other devices in the haptic domain or even in the glove domain.
Those two are representing a thinking which is a combination of both research. How do we generate more realistic expressions to people with the thinking of how do we make that feasible to be a product for consumers.
Right now, we're just at the inception of technology of haptics, learning how to appease and make believe, not necessarily beyond a shadow of a doubt, but enough fidelity there that, okay, I believe I'm holding somebody's liver in my hands. I think it's going to be a long time till we see a one-size-fits-all, if there is. For more information about what we see the future of haptics, please visit the following links. Feel free to visit our Haptic Controllers and Rich Haptics for Mixed Reality site, or take a look at our latest announcements in our blog. You can also view our latest publications and videos, and feel free to contact us. We're happy to discuss these subjects with you. We hope these brief presentations of our devices and our view of haptics has inspired you. Hope to see a lot of you in research in the haptic topic in the future. And thank you and goodbye.
We have to actually rethink the entire AI stack.
What is reinforcement learning? Let's look at an interactive demo.
All our code is now open source.